Good morning, all of you in internet land. We're glad to have you with us today, and we got the crowd with us, and Harley is actually chasing her squirrel right now, but she'll settle down in a minute. She always does. But she's just so excited to see everybody, and we are too. We're glad that you're with us, and we believe the Lord has good things for all of us today. Let's have a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you for this moment, this time that we have together as friends, as family of God, as those who are known of you and are loved by you. And Lord, we love you. And we ask that today, Lord, we could really be close to you, learn of you, and that you would do something good in our midst, not only here, but for all who are joining with us too by way of the internet. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we're going to start out with a hand-clapping, foot-stomping song to praise God with that you're all going to know as soon as you hear it. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine every day, every day, every day, every night and day. I'm gonna let it shine, this little light of mine. Haven't tried a bush or no, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bush or no, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bush or no, I'm gonna let it shine. Every day, every day, every day, every night and day, I'm gonna let it shine, this little light of mine. Today, let's just clap to him and praise him. Huh? Amen. And every day we're going to let it shine because Jesus is good and we want to tell the whole world about him, don't we? Amen. Well, a lot of amens on that one. Amen and amen, huh? Well, there's another good song. Got to get my cable set here. Right, and
yes,
you know, that's I can at least say I'm making a noise. Somebody said the other day, I hear you, you're a singer. I said, yeah, I've heard a lot of ears in my life. So but as long as we're making a joyful noise, how many know that's all that matters? And and give it as unto the Lord, and it doesn't matter, he's not sitting around waiting for us to be you know, some kind of famous singer. He just loves that we're singing to him. And as long as it comes from our heart to him, he receives it as worship through Jesus' name. Amen. And so we make a great joyful noise to the Lord. We sang this last week, but I love it so much, I just want to sing it one more time today. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sun comes out, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Heart is kind, for all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. On that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Jesus today. He is God who became a man, dwelt among us to die for our sins and to teach us who God really is. I had somebody say to me the other day, he said, I wish God would just come down here and tell us what's really right. I said, he did. He did. His name is Jesus, and he came to show us God. And he said, well, I wish you'd give us some laws that are up to date. And I said, well, I think the Ten Commandments are up to date. Love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and might. Love your neighbor as yourself. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't lie. Don't covet your neighbor's property. How many think those are all pretty modern-day things that we should live by? And so, you know, the Lord has come in Jesus to show us who God really is and how we can just really rest in him. I'm going to ask Kathleen to come and share in prayer request time, and then we're going to move right into our Bible study this morning.
Mm-hmm. Good morning. So good to see you and to have you with us, and you out there as well. I think we're this way. Hi to Margaret and Joe. Love you guys. Wish you were here. Do we have special prayer requests today?
Brendan
yet. Yes, he's still hanging in there. God's just not ready to take him, is he? No. Good. Anything else? No? Okay. We prayed for Don last week, and my daughter, who is taking her dad to Minnesota, to the Mayo Clinic, and he continued to get weaker. They had to admit him, and now he's in a cardiac ward, so it's been one thing after another for him. So my daughter was there all week. She went home for the weekend and had her uncle come and stay with him while she's at home with her family for the weekend. And my son, Rob, is flying there tomorrow. Oh, no, today. Today. And then they're going to drive to Minnesota together, brother and sister. So we just need to remember them and the whole family right now. Because there's lots going on. Lots going on there. And are you going to talk about Convoy at all, honey?
Yeah.
Are you? Okay. Yeah. Well, let's pray for Convoy. That was the ministry that we were at this past week, and Rod was for, you were there for a golf outing. And the whole time met wonderful people who were Christians and wanting to help, and he's going to talk about all the programs and all the good that they're doing in the world and how we might be a part of that. So let's pray for them too. Anything for you, honey, special?
You covered it, maybe.
Yeah, okay. And I'd like to ask prayer too for me, for my neck problems and vision problems right now. They seem to be escalating and causes blood pressure issues and some other issues too. So I would just like some wisdom. So shall we join in prayer? Mm-hmm. Father God, we praise your holy name this day, and we are just so privileged to be in a country where we can worship you and we have access to your word, and that we can practice our faith here freely. We pray that that never go away in this country. We pray for all of our government. We pray for all that's going on in this land concerning you and concerning the spiritual warfare that's going on, winning the hearts and winning the souls, Lord. That's really what we want to be about. And help us to do that in a way that is glorifying to you. Lord, forgive us when our prayers seem almost rote and we may just grow weary of the sameness of them every day. Just come with your Holy Spirit and breathe a fresh breath on us that renews us today and always, that we can get through the week and just love you and grow closer to you every day. Let your scripture come alive, that we see that you're speaking to us and that you love us and that you care for us. We love you. And Father, we have prayer requests that we'd like to lift before you. We think of Brendan, Lord, who has cancer, and you have purpose yet for him, Lord, and we trust you with him and ask that these days, if you can heal him, Lord, we ask that. And we ask that too for Don, as he's at Mayo Clinic now and all the doctors have met. And we just pray for wisdom for all of them, that he might be touched and he might be healed. Be with all the family as they're congregating and getting together. And just give them a happy time together, Lord. And Lord, I pray too for me, for my neck and my back and my vision and all that goes with that, Lord. You know what needs to happen, and I ask a special touch from you. I know you are the great healer and the great physician, and I ask a touch. Give me wisdom as far as what to do, but I start with you first, Lord. And Father, I think of Mary, who's ailing her vision, and I still, Lord, pray for her. She is such a beautiful woman of you, and so caring and wanting to bless others, and just bless her for that attitude too, Lord, and make these days her best yet, that she can just rely on you and give her patience as she's going through this blindness and what she faces every day that we have no idea. We pray for Richard and ask a strengthening of his knees, and that he might find some doctors that would relieve some of his pain as well. And we pray for Carmel as she's getting ready to go in for serious surgery, Lord. And we just pray that the diverticulitis and all that's going on there would be calmed down, and that she would find times of rest and times of readiment for recuperation. Lord, we pray for Virginia, who's in the hospital now and who's going to be ready to come home soon. And we pray for her strengthening, that this decisions would be made that would be good for her, Lord, as far as where she needs to go and what she needs to do. We pray for Convoy, and we pray for their ministry, Lord. What a wonderful group of people, Lord, that blessed us so. And we just ask that people would be helped in Thailand, in the Philippines, in Africa, in all the many nations where they are, and where they are giving not just food, but they're giving the knowledge of you and your love. And now bless Rod as he speaks. Anoint him with your Holy Spirit. Give him a fresh spirit too. And Lord, give us fresh ears and eyes to see how this word pertains to us individually, Lord, that we might grow closer to you and stronger in you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Kathleen. Well, we were at TCP Sawgrass, which is any of you that are familiar with golf and the golf world. I don't know how that got moved. But any of you that are familiar with the golf world, you know that that's where they play one of the four majors, and it's the major they play there is the one called the Players, and so it's. Yeah, this is real tender, getting it just right. Anyhow, so they took us all up there and let us play for a couple days. You say, now, they paid for that out of the ministry? No, there were corporate sponsors who wanted to bless pastors, and they paid for all of that for us to go and play and experience that. So anybody who's a golfer knows, this is really a special experience. Now, Carmel, you would know that because you were married to a pro-am golfer who won the British Open, isn't that right? Mm-hmm. Two times?
No, he was runner-up once and once.
Runner-up once and won it one time. So, you know, this was just like a historic, nostalgic treat, you know, just to even be there. And, of course, then they used that as a venue to share their ministry. Now, I've been associated with Convoy of Hope for over 20 years. Our church in Indiana supported it. We've done many other projects with them over the years. They started out as a disaster relief ministry and just started buying trucks and would show up when there was like a hurricane disaster or tornado disaster and show up with food and water and clothing and just reach out and help people. They've expanded that now into feeding children and having a real emphasis on a feeding program and then empowering women, helping women around the world who are desolate to be able to become entrepreneurs and develop their own business. Now, it may not seem like much of a business maybe where we come from, but in some cases, this might be that they have a few acres of ground and they start planting it and they sell, but they're able to plant and sell enough to support their family in those economies. Or like one woman that we watched a video on was moved out, clear out of a life of prostitution into self-sufficiency for her and her children by raising chickens. So Convo taught her how to do it and supplied her with the first chickens. Well, I mean, once you get a few chickens going, they managed to get themselves rolling right along. And it wasn't long before she had, you know, this really huge chicken farm. So, you know, they're a great ministry. Now, one of the things that they're doing is linking local churches with communities that have an orphanage. That's the thing that I'm really hoping that we can target. They have communities down in Haiti where we've been working that have orphanages that need to be supported. And some of those orphanages, there might be 40 kids, maybe 50, maybe 100 kids. And what we are wanting to do is be able to support a whole orphanage of 40 or 50 children. And what they'll do for us is they'll supply us pictures of the facility, pictures of the children, updates, where we can have those right on our website, and all of us can go right to the website, see the children, be praying for them on a daily basis, getting updates, and I'm sure even be able to write back and forth, you know, with some of the children and have some real communication. And for just $10 a child a month, we'll be able to do that. So I'm, you know, we're looking at $500 a month being able to support a whole orphanage. And then maybe one of these days, some of us can go all together down to Haiti and visit those children and have, you know, fellowship with them. So I'd like for you just to really start praying with me about that. Kathleen and I are already talking about it, and I know that we would like to personally support at least 10 of those children and maybe be able to do some more than that. And if some of you could join in with us, it wouldn't take very much money, and it wouldn't be very hard for us to support together a whole orphanage. That'd be kind of exciting, wouldn't it? And then be in, like I said, constant contacting and care with it. So just put that on your prayer list with us, and we're waiting. I don't have any details yet because I talked to our contact man, and he said, well, that whole orphanage thing is a different department than I represent. So he said, I'm out of town. When I get back in town, I'll have that department contact you, give you all of the detail, and then we'll get you rolling on that. So hopefully by next Sunday, we'll have some pictures to show and some detail and targets and things going on. And so just be praying with us about that. And of course, Richard and Mary, as you go back north, you can stay in touch with us through the video. On the internet, we'll make sure you get the links for all that and be just looking right along with us. Amen. Well, God is good. And you say, how did I golf? You know, that's been the big question. Terrible. I golfed terrible. But, you know, the Lord is so good. He put me with a guy who golfed really good. So we did really good because he did really good. How many know sometimes it's not what you know, it's who you know. Can everybody say amen to that? And so the Lord put me with the right guy, and he pushed us on, and we did really good. But I had a good time, and I had a good time. I froze my my toes off. I was going to say something else, but I shouldn't say that. But I froze my toes off. I mean, I was so cold. I couldn't believe it. It was Tuesday and Wednesday when that real cold snap came down here. And the wind on Wednesday was blowing 20 miles an hour the whole time, and it never made it out of the 40s. I think we started in the high 30s and maybe got to the mid-40s, 20 mile per hour wind. So you can just imagine how cold that was, being out there trying to hit a golf ball. I'm trying to make you feel sorry for me. Am I doing a good job of it? You know, I've been suffering for Jesus playing golf. And it doesn't quite match up, does it? But that was our experience this week. So we had a good time. Well, we've been talking about spiritual warfare, and we're in part four. This will be our final week that we talk about it. And I'm hoping that you at home can see the screen better. We've had just such problems, but we keep trying to make this better for you. So hopefully this is going to work. But we're talking about spiritual warfare, and today, especially, we're going to talk about the weapons of our warfare, because God has given us weapons. Now, we talked about the armor a few weeks ago, but today I want to go a little bit different route and focus on these weapons. So let me remind you of our scripture that we had starting out with. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." So a couple of weeks ago, we had a picture of a guy's brain open and the battle going on. The battlefield is in the mind, and that's what the scripture says. And Satan is fighting for the minds of people. He's fighting for the minds of our children. He's fighting for our minds. How many of you have ever noticed that the minute you decide you're going to really focus on the Lord, there's 100 other things that start popping in your head? And you say, what is that? Well, that's spiritual warfare. Satan is fighting for our minds. And sometimes we just have to stand up against Satan and say, "I resist you," and say to those thoughts, "Get out of here. I cast you down in the name of Jesus," and really take control of our mind, because that's where Satan tries to rob us of the things that God wants to give to us. And that's the battlefield. Now, it's not only a battlefield in our mind, but it's a battlefield in everybody's mind. And for those who don't know the Lord, they're held captive. They're already imprisoned in those areas. And so we have to try to do everything that we can to see them set free. Jesus wants to set them free. And he wants to use us to help them to get free. Now, what are our weapons? Well, here's the first one I want to focus on. We talked about it briefly the other week, but I want to come back to it. Prayer is our first weapon. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, Jesus said, "This kind," speaking of a demon that was possessing a child. How many remember the story? And the demon was causing the child to throw himself in the fire over and over again. And the father came to the disciples and said, will you help my child and set him free? And they tried to cast the demon out and couldn't do it. And so then they brought the man and the child to Jesus. Do you all remember this? And Jesus cast the demon out. And so the disciples said, "Why couldn't we cast the demon out?" And he said, "This kind only goes out with fasting and prayer." So there are certain demonic powers that we fight against that it is only by prayer and even with fasting and seeking the Lord that we're going to be able to break through those strongholds and help people to get free. So prayer is a very important part of our ministry. So Jesus himself, when he was here on earth, I think we all know he laid down his divinity, his godly glory, and operated as purely a human. And he prayed. Do you know that over and over again, you read the scriptures, you find Jesus taking maybe a whole night, you know, where he was praying and seeking the Lord. And if Jesus had to pray to be able to have victory over these demonic attacks, over these satanic attacks, well, then how many know that's what we got to do too? There is no shortcut. You know, we can't say, well, the victory's already won, so we don't need to do that anymore. No, no. The victory may be won, but there's still a battle to be fought. The war is won, but the battles are still going on. And we have to claim every victory in Jesus' name, and we have to lay hold of it through prayer, and in some cases, with fasting. So our praying, to be effective, must be in the name of Jesus. He never one time said, you can pray in the name of anybody. You know, you can pray Hindu prayers. How many know the Hindu religion was already in existence in the days of Jesus? Or you can pray, you know, a Buddhist prayer. Or you could pray, you know, in some other religion. Or he didn't name some idol. He didn't say that. As a matter of fact, the Bible talks about those religions and the religions of all those idols and says that it's worthless praying and that God doesn't hear prayers that are prayed in that fashion. And do you remember that that Israel was worshiping those idols in the day of Elijah? Do you remember this? And he said, let's prove who God really is. You get out there and pray to your gods. And the God they were worshiping was Baal, which was literally the god of the flies. Can you imagine being a fly worshiper? I mean, that's just kind of sick, you know, the whole thing. You know, there's, when you think about what flies do and how they function and operate, what they feed on, and, you know, and this is what they worship. But, you know, they worship, you know, the god of the flies, Baal. And so these Baal worshipers were out there all day cutting themselves and crying out to their god, and nothing happened. Elijah got out there and said, douse the fire with water. And they took thousands upon thousands of gallons of water and doused the sacrifice and all of the wood around it.
Altar.
And pardon?
Altar.
And the whole altar area, and just filled it, you know, with water, because he wanted to make sure everybody knew there was no trickery at hand, that this was God doing this. And then he stood back and he didn't pray all day. He just said, okay, Lord God, show this day who God really is. And he stepped back and God let fire fall from heaven and it consumed those sacrifices just like that in a split second. You know, and he was declaring, look, it's not all these other religions. It's not all this idolatry. It's not all of these things. There isn't many gods or many religions, you know, that get you to the same God. They're not worshiping the same God. He was declaring, I am God, and I alone am God. And these things, you can't come to me through these things. You have to come to me through the way that I've given you. You say, well, what's that way? Well, Jesus made it clear. He said in John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So it's praying in Jesus' name. Jesus said, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And then in John 15:16, he said, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask in the Father, look at this again, in my name, he may give you. So he listens when we come through Jesus. Jesus is the way. And when we come through his name, God's ear is open to us and God hears our prayers and God answers our prayers. Praise the Lord. Now I've been walking with the Lord over 40 years now, 46, 47 years now. And I've seen God answer so many prayers and do it in such miraculous ways that there was no question it was God. And I'm glad to say God hears our prayers and answers our prayer. We say, what's so important about prayer? Well, prayer is relationship with God. What kind of relationship would Kathleen and I have if I never spoke to her and she never spoke to me? But because we speak, you know, she can, and because she knows I love her, she can say, honey, I want, she said to me yesterday, she said, honey, I saw a table at Tuesday, what's it called, Tuesday?
Morning.
I always want to call that Ruby Tuesday, but that's the restaurant, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's because food is on my mind, but Tuesday morning. And she said, honey, I want this table. And she described it to me. She said, will you come look at it with me? And I said, okay. So we went over and looked at it. And, of course, I knew already I was going to say yes. You know, why would I say no? My wife wants a table. How many know there's only one answer to that question? And yes, we'll get the table. And so we came home with the table and put it on the lanai. But, you know, before we came home, I said to her, I said, well, I want a golf club. And how many know that works really good, you know? So she came home with a table and I came home with a golf club. But, you know, prayer is a relationship with God. We're talking to Him, and we can also hear Him talk back to us. Now, I've never heard God speak audibly to me. There are those who have, but I've never had that experience. But I have heard God speak into my heart over and over again. Sometimes he says to me things like, no. How many have ever heard God say, no, don't do that, don't go that direction? And, you know, that's the voice of God, you know, warning us, caring for us. And sometimes He just wants me to know that He loves me. And sometimes He just wants me to know it's going to be okay. And sometimes He says, I remember when we went to build the church in Auburn, Indiana, we went there because God started speaking into my heart. I want you to go here. And I remember there were those that said to me, you can't do that. There's nothing there. But, you know, God was sending me there. And when we got there, we started with a little Bible study like this. It soon grew to 100 people. And a few years later, we were building a building and congregation grew to several hundred people because God spoke to our heart and sent us there. Prayer is this relationship with God. And when we're linked up like that, we're a team. Kathleen and I are a team going out conquering tables and golf clubs together in Jesus' name, or, well, at least in our name. But we're out there doing it together. And in the same way, when we link up with God, we are a team with God going out taking territory for the glory of God and conquering those things that are resisting what the Lord wants and helping and ministering to people together in Jesus' name. So it's this relationship. And I always think of this scripture, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy. So look what God's saying. He's saying, I love you. And I've made the way through Jesus Christ, your high priest. And the previous scripture says He's passed through the veil and opened the way. There used to be a veil that separated God from man. But when Jesus died on the cross, it was ripped from the top to the bottom. And it was God's way of saying, you're no longer separated from me. Your sin is taken care of. So come and come boldly into my presence. I love you and I want to help you. Come and have a relationship with me and let me touch you. Let me minister to you. What a wonderful thing prayer is. Jesus defeated the devil to set us free. Kathleen and I are reading this scripture in devotions this week, Hebrews 2:14. It says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, He Himself likewise shared in the same, that through death He might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetimes subject to bondage. So Satan had control of death in this sense. It's not in the sense that he can decide when somebody's going to die, but he had, through his deception, and brought sin in and brought separation between God and man. And had Jesus never died on the cross for our sins, then Satan would have won, and he would have had the control to take every man, woman, and child into eternal separation from God and into hell forever and ever. And he kept people in bondage in fear of that. But the Lord Jesus came and set us free by dying for our sins. And because He died for our sins and rose from the dead, He defeated the power that Satan has in death, because now my sin is put on Jesus, and instead of I having sin, I have His righteousness. And when God looks at me, he sees the righteousness of Christ in me and says, you don't belong to the devil anymore. You belong to me. You don't have to go with him into a Christless eternity. You can come to heaven and be in heaven with me forever and ever. And you can live in this world with me. Praise God. How many know that is victory? Amen. And has then released us from the fear of death. You know, before I became a Christian, I remember laying in my bed being afraid, what's going to happen to me if I die in the night? And even would try to imagine, what's going to happen to me if I die through the night? But after I received Jesus, I've not had 1 ounce of that fear. I've got confidence. I know that I know that I know when I die, I'm going to go right into his presence and be with Jesus. Praise God. And there's no longer any fear of death. And so Satan can't control me anymore. I've been set free by Jesus Christ. So we have this victory that we can go right into God's presence. We have the righteousness of Christ. And when we go into God's presence, he doesn't see us in our sin. He sees us in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And so we can come in boldly and ask what we need and receive from the Lord those things that we need. Now, when we pray, God sends angels to fight our battles. Hebrews 2:13 says, but to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstools? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation? How many here are planning on going to heaven? How many here are planning on inheriting that salvation? Then this is talking about you. And here's what happens. When we pray, God hears our prayer, and he starts sending angels to answer our prayer. And he dispatches angels. So, you know, the more we pray, the more angels God sends, you know, and the more they're there to help us. And so prayer is so mighty and so powerful and so important in the spiritual battle, because God sends us the spiritual army that we need to overcome the enemy in every single situation. Now, prayer is not only a great weapon, but praising God is a great, great weapon. You say, what do you mean by praising God? Well, what we were doing earlier, if we did that from our heart, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. If we were singing from our heart to the Lord, we were praising God. We were magnifying him, lifting him up, glorifying God. And the Bible says that when we praise God, use our lips, use our heart, our mind, soul, and might to give glory and praise to God, that it brings defeat to the enemy. Look what happened to Israel. It says, now when they began to sing and to praise God, the Lord set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who had come against Judah. So there was an enemy coming against Judah trying to destroy them. Do you know what the word Judah means? Anybody know? The word Judah means praise. And you know where the enemy will attack us? He'll attack our praise. He'll try to get us to get all bitter and grumpy and complaining and griping. You say, why? Because when we're bitter and grumpy and complaining, the enemy can rule against us. But when we decide to throw all of that off and put on the garment of praise, the Bible says, and begin to praise God for his goodness and for who he is and for what he's done and what we believe he's going to do, and really bless him and take on an attitude that is positive in God, saying, God, I know you're on the throne. God, I know you're there. God, I know you're going to take care of this, and I'm just praising you for it in advance. When we begin to do that, then God sets up ambushes against the enemy and begins to fight our battle for us. And it says, and they, the enemy, was defeated. And that's exactly what happens for us in Jesus Christ. So when the enemy comes against us and we don't feel like praising God, that's the time that we need to praise him the most. when it looks really bad and it looks like we're going down and we're going to be defeated, that's when it's time to begin to praise God even more and say, oh God, I just praise you. I thank you. I glorify you. I like the attitude of the children of Israel who were in the, how many remember they got thrown in the fiery furnace? Do you remember that story? And they got in there and the king said, look, you either bow down and worship my idols or we're going to turn this fire up and kill you. And he mocked them and said, your God can't deliver you. And you know what those children of Israel said? They said, you know what? We know our God can deliver us from this fire. He can do it if he wants to. And we're praising him for it. But if he doesn't, we're still going to praise God. And we're not bowing down to your idols. We're still going to glorify God. Because even if he lets the fire consume us, God is still good and he's got a plan. How many know we look at death so negative, but they knew that on the other side of death was they were going to be with the Lord. And the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Oh, listen, when we praise God, when we bless him, when we glorify him, hallelujah, there is victory that comes our direction. And the Bible says Satan flees when we praise God. Psalms 149 says, let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud on their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. And so when we are praising God, we are putting on spiritual weapons and warfare that causes the enemy to be confused and causes him to flee. Here's another weapon, preaching. Preaching. You say, why do you so believe in preaching? Well, I believe in it because it's a spiritual weapon that defeats Satan. Remember I talked about the battlefield is in the mind? And how are people going to be free if they don't know what they're supposed to believe? But if they know what they're supposed to believe, then they can believe it, and by faith, they can be delivered and be set free. And so the Bible says, how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? So somebody, through some means, whether it's over a device, you know, on the internet, or handing out a tract, or standing, you know, in an auditorium and preaching, or preaching over television, or somewhere, somebody needs to stand up and proclaim the truth that Jesus is God who died for our sins. He rose from the dead, that we are free in him, and that whosoever believes in him shall be saved. But how are they going to believe if they don't hear? And so the Bible says, verse 17, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now, how does our faith grow? Same way. Faith comes by hearing. So we need to be under anointed preaching, preaching where the word of God is preached, so our faith will be stirred up, so our faith will grow. And so as our faith grows and we know what to believe, we can stand against the devil and win the victory. So preaching is an important element. And that's why, you know, it's not a matter of, I got to go to church because, you know, this is the law. And, you know, if I don't go to church, God's going to be mad at me. No, God's not mad at you. He's going to be mad at you. Oh, he already put away all of his anger in Jesus on the cross. It's not about that. But it is about this. God wants you free. God wants you to be free. God wants you to have freedom in your life from Satan, from his demons. God wants you to have freedom in your life to really live the full life, the abundant life that God has for you. And the only way that's going to come is if you're sitting somewhere under anointed preaching, hearing the word of God, and then believing what God says through the word of God. And as your faith is mixed with the word of God, then you begin to see the power of God released and God do mighty, wonderful miracles. John chapter 8, verse 31 says, Jesus said to those Jews who believed, if you abide in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The word disciple is the whole idea of a learner. It's the idea of somebody sitting at someone's feet being taught, listening. And that's what preaching is all about. Preaching and teaching the Word of God is all about learning the Word of God. And Jesus said, if we'll learn the Word of God and follow Him and apply that Word to our lives, the truth will make us free and give us victory over our enemy, who is the devil. Now, the next weapon that we have is the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of the Holy Spirit. Did you know the Holy Spirit's in this room? Do you know why? The Holy Spirit is in every believer. I asked you to raise hands a while ago. How many know you're going to heaven? You all raised your hands. Now, the only way you can know that is that you're a believer, right? And if you are a believer, you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. So you know what? The Holy Spirit's in this room. Why? Because we all brought the Holy Spirit in here with us. And that's one of the reasons why there is power in two or three of us gathering in His name. Because we all have the same Holy Spirit. And He's working together in us and through us for the glory of God. Acts 1:8 says, "You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you and be my witnesses." So there is power in the Spirit. There is authority in Jesus' name. Mark 16:17 says, "These signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons, they will speak in tongues," and it goes on with a whole list of signs and wonders that will follow the believers. And so the power of the Spirit comes into our lives. So that by the power of the Spirit, not by Rod Buzzard's power, you know, it's not about, oh, Rod, that Rod Buzzard, he's such a good man and such a holy man. That doesn't mean anything. That's, first of all, he's not such a good man. He's not such a holy man. Ask Kathleen, but please don't ask Kathleen. I don't want her to tell you, you know, all that stuff. But, you know, we're how we know we're all flesh and blood, isn't that right? And we're just people. But the Holy Spirit, That's another thing. When the Holy Spirit comes in us and anoints us, the anointing and the power of the Spirit that comes with that anointing turns us into a different person. And while we're operating under that anointing, there is power. And there are signs and wonders that follow. So there is. It's not my power. I've seen people healed over and over again, but it wasn't my power that healed them. It was the Holy Spirit that touched them and healed them. And I've seen God do miraculous things. This talks about speaking in tongues. And you say, what is that? Well, this is the prayer language where we get baptized in the Spirit, not in water, but in the Spirit. And we begin to speak in languages we've never learned. And the Bible says this, our spirit speaking to God by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we have a direct line, a direct contact with God. And you know, just to give you an example of this, I know I'm in danger of repeating myself, but sometimes it's good to repeat myself. We had a missions conference in our church several years ago. And we had people from all over the world there. And at the end of the service, everybody that was there I knew were Christians. And they were all Christians that understood speaking in tongues. So it wasn't of getting ready to tell you what I did wasn't out of order because of the context. There were not any unbelievers to get confused. But I just said to everybody, let's pray for the world. Join hands and let's just pray for the world with our spirit language. And everybody began to pray that way. Well, there was a woman there who was from Spain, a missionary in Spain. And after we got done praying, she raised her hand and said, "Can I say something, Pastor?" I said, "Sure." And she came up on the platform and she said, "I want you to know that while we were praying, I heard the man next to me pray." And she looked at him and she said, "I want to ask you, sir, do you speak Spanish?" And he said, "No." She said, "Have you ever been to Spain?" He said, "No." "Do you know any Spanish words at all?" He said, "No." He said, "I want you to know I heard him praying in perfect Castilian Spanish." And I understood everything he said, and here's what he said. And she interpreted it for us, everything he said. This miraculous sign and wonder was taking place by the power of the Holy Spirit. Listen, God doesn't just turn us loose and say, now just have a dry little religion and just, you know, practice your dry. No, he says, I'm going to give you power, and the power of the Spirit is going to rest on you, and the power of the Spirit is going to work through you, and you're going to see signs and wonders and miracles, and it's not about you and how good you are. It's about God and how good he is. It's not about how powerful you are. It's about how powerful he is. And he's going to do signs and wonders. And we've seen it over and over again. I know we've seen it time and time again when the doctor said, come and get ready, this person's going to die. And we began praying for him. And the next thing you know, they got completely well. And the doctors were just stumped. They would just say, we don't even understand how this happens, how it happened. You know, they should have been dead, but they were alive. How many are glad that God can do anything? Isn't that right? With God, all things are possible. And so we know that God is a mighty God. And because of that, we have power against the enemy. And then number five, that we are placed in the body of Christ. Now, this is really important because we all know the scripture. I say to you, you are Peter. And I've talked about this before. The word Peter there means a small stone. There's a play on words that Jesus uses here. You are Peter, Petros, the small stone, just like a little bitty stone. And on this rock, Petra, which means a massive rock, like the rock of Gibraltar, you know, the kind of rock that you build on. He said, I will build my church. Now, here's the play on words. He wasn't talking about building the church on the small stone. How many know that wouldn't make sense? But Peter had just said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father which is in heaven. He was saying, I'm going to build my church on this revelation. Now, how do you know that's true? Well, when you get over in the book of 1 Peter, Peter repeats the same formula, but he applies it to Jesus. And he says, all of us are living stones, Petros, little stones, being built in the temple, being built on the foundation stone, Petra, the massive stone, which is Christ. So Peter interpreted it for us. He made it very clear that the church is built on Jesus Christ. And he is that massive rock. That Peter is one of those stones, and we are one of those stones. And Peter was a foundational stone, no question about it. He was one of the, very important stones. But that it's Jesus that is the foundation, massive rock of the church. And so he said, look at this. I don't want us to miss this. He says this, when I build my church, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Listen, the church is not an organization. It's not a denomination. It is not a building. The church is made up of all of the believers in the world. So all of us together and all of the believers together are the church. And what does it say? It says, look, when we are a part of his church, when we are linked in, the gates of hell cannot prevail against his church. It is so important in this spiritual warfare that we be connected to church, to being a part of going to church and worshiping. And we need to be in a church where the word is preached. We need to be in a church where prayer is prayed powerfully. And we need to be in a church where faith is being built and shared. And it says, and I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This is power in the spiritual warfare. Now God gives us discernment. It says, by this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. Now, we need to watch this, because he's saying there are people out here who claim to be spiritual and even will say they're Christians, but he said you need to discern whether or not they really are. And here's the acid test. If they really are Christians, they will confess that Jesus is God who came in the flesh, died for their sins, and rose from the dead. If they will not confess that, then they are not of the truth. And we have to know that just because somebody says they're Christian, somebody says they're spiritual, doesn't mean that they are. So we need to find out what they believe concerning Jesus Christ. And it says, and every spirit that does not confess Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. You remember a couple weeks ago we talked about doctrines of demons? So there are some churches, some people, some institutions, some groups that are preaching things, but they're not coming from the Holy Spirit. They're coming from demons. They're demon-possessed people, and they are teaching these doctrines of demons. And so we find out, how do we know if they are doctrines of demons or not? Well, are they confessing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Are they confessing him that he is God who came in the flesh and died for their sins? If they're not, then they're not of God. Are they confessing that Jesus is the only way of salvation? If they're not, then they are not of God. This is the spirit of Antichrist, John says, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. But we need to know that God is greater than the devil. He said, goes on to say, you are of God, little children, and have overcome this spirit of Antichrist, these demons preaching these false doctrines. You have overcome them, little children, because he who is in you, speaking of Christ by the Holy Spirit living in you, is greater than he who is in the world. So even if all the demons and all of the fallen angels and Satan himself come against you, you have something greater in you than all of that put together. And that is God himself. You are the temple of God. You have the Holy Spirit living in you. You have the power of God. And you are connected to the church that Jesus said the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That you are guaranteed the victory. Praise God. So God is greater than all these things. And in Jesus, we have the victory. So I want to just close today by having a moment of prayer. And here's what I want to do. I want to pray for you. And if I've got a little anointing oil. The Bible says that if there's any sick among you, let them call for the elders and have them anoint them with oil and pray for the sick. And that the prayer of faith will save the sick and the Lord will raise them up. So I just want to anoint you. This oil doesn't have any magical power. It's just olive oil. And the same kind of olive oil we cook with. But it's a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And we can release our faith in God's promise and say, yes, Holy Spirit, touch me. As this oil touches me, I receive that anointing power and touch from you, Holy Spirit. So I'm going to play, just let a song play up here. And while we're letting the song play, we're going to pray for you. And we're going to believe that the Lord is just going to touch you. So if you'd like to have prayer, just lift your hand and I'll come to you one at a time and we'll just pray together. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God.
answer and answer. Let your anointing rest on us with a wisdom. Understand from on high. Let her walk in that I pray. Give her the strength that I pray.
God. Let's just worship the Lord. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just in your own way, just draw near to Jesus here today. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
On eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise. I will
Lord, we thank you. You're here with us, and we have anointed your children, and we believe the Holy Spirit has been released in power. We come against every foul and unclean spirit, every demonic spirit that is trying to hurt your children in any way. We bind those spirits in the name of Jesus, and we command you to flee. Take your hands off of them, that there be no confusion or sickness. And Lord, we're trusting you for this touch. It would come by the power of God in the name of Jesus and through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. God is good, isn't he? Well, we're going to conclude our... Yeah, let's just give him the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to say goodbye to you, our friends. Email us. Let us know what's going on with you. Send us your prayer request. We'll pray with you too. God bless.